grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. Please stand together and join in singing hymn number 321, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name, verses 1, 3, and 5. Celebrate our new life in Christ. As a heads up this morning, during the Eucharistic prayer, we are going to sing the Holy, Holy, Holy. We've been saying it for a long time. We're going to sing it again this morning. So Evelyn will start us on the music and we will follow. We continue on page 185 of the Green Service Book. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
As we gather in our Lord's presence, together we pray. Almighty God, to you
all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us join in the collect of the day printed in your bulletin. Almighty God, you have created the heavens and the earth, and ourselves in your image. Teach us to discern your hand in all your works, and to serve you with reverence and thanksgiving. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the proclamation of God's word.
A Jeremiah. My joy is gone, grief is upon me, my heart is sick. Hark the cry of my poor people from far and wide in the land. Is the Lord not in Zion? Is her king not in her? Why have they provoked me to anger with their images, with their foreign idols? The harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. For the hurt of my poor people, I am hurt. I mourn, and dismay has taken hold of me. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then has the health of my poor people not been restored? Oh, that my head were a spring of water, and my eyes a fountain of tears, so that I might weep day and night for the slain of my poor people. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the children.
Thanks be to God.
Our appointed psalm is a portion of Psalm 79, found on page 811. We'll read verses 1 to 9, alternately verse by verse. Page 811, Psalm 79, verses 1 to 9. God, the heathen have come into your inheritance. They have profaned your holy temple. They have made Jerusalem a heap of rubble.
They have given the bodies of your servants as food for birds of the air, and the flesh of your faithful ones to the beasts of the field.
They have shed their blood like water on every side in Jerusalem, and there was no one to bury them.
We have become a reproach to our neighbors,
how long will you be angry, O Lord? Will your fury blaze like fire forever?
Pour out your wrath upon the heathen without numbering them, and upon the heathens that have not followed
after me. They have devoured Jacob and made his dwelling a ruin.
Remember not our past sins. Let your compassion be swift to meet us, for we have been our very low.
Help us, O God, our Savior, for the glory of your name. Deliver us and forgive us our sins, for your name's sake. Together the prayer.
Gracious God, in the times of sorrow and depression, when hope itself seems lost, help us to remember the transforming power of your steadfast love, and to give thanks for that new life we can now imagine. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
A reading from Paul's letter to Timothy. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for everyone, for kings and all who are in high positions, so that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and dignity. This is right and is acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires everyone to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God. There is also one mediator between God and humankind, Christ Jesus, himself human, who gave himself a ransom for all. This was attested at the right time. For this I was appointed a herald and an apostle. I am telling the truth, I am not lying. A teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Then Jesus said to the disciples, There was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was squandering his property. So he summoned him and said to him, "What is this that I hear about you? Give me an accounting of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer." Then the manager said to himself, "What will I do now that my master is taking the position away from me? I am not strong enough to dig. I am ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do so that when I am dismissed as manager, people may welcome me into their homes." So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he asked the first, "How much do you owe my master?" He answered, 100 jugs of olive oil." He said to him, "Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 50. Then he asked another, "And how much do you owe?" He replied, 100 containers of wheat." He said to him, "Take your bill and make it 80. And his master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. "For the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it is gone, they may welcome you into the eternal homes. Whoever is faithful in a very little is faithful also in much, and whoever is dishonest in a very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have not been faithful with a dishonest wealth, who will entrust you the true riches? And if you have not been faithful with what belongs to another, who will give you what is your own? No slave can serve both two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
As we gather this day in your presence, Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit would open our hearts to see you and know you. Come, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. I don't know how many are aware, but we follow a 3-year reading cycle. So it's year A, B, C. We're in year C, and we're near the end of year C, because in a couple of months we start over again. And lately it's been kind of feeling like all those readings they didn't know what to do with, they just waited to the end, and we get all the tough ones at the end of your C. There's a passage in the first letter to the Corinthians that I think helps us with this morning's parable that Jesus tells his disciples. The passage I'm thinking of is often referred to as the wedding passage because it's all about love and it's often read at weddings. The main exhortation of the passage is to put loving others over and above your own accomplishments. The passage points out that we don't actually grasp the big picture of life, but we can know that love is the foundation to life. The passage ends with this observation. "For now, it is as if we are looking through a muddy glass, but then we will see face to face. For now, my knowledge is full of holes, but when the time comes, I will know God as God fully knows me." The parable that we just heard of Jesus about the dishonest manager is about as clear as looking through a muddy window. All parables are a bit of a puzzle, but this one really leaves us scratching our heads. Which probably means it was a parable that Jesus told. Why else would it be included in a document written for the purpose of sharing the good news of God in Christ, when we all end up a bit confused when we hear it? So, peering through this muddy window into this parable, do we see anything that is somewhat nurturing and life-giving? The passage that I shared from the first letter to the Corinthians about love encourage us to see our relationships with one another and the love that is nurtured in those relationships as the most important part of our lives as we journey along in life. Perhaps this disturbing parable tries to shake us awake to the same reality. In the parable, there is a rich man who has hired a manager to take care of his financial affairs. The rich man is doing business with a number of other people in the community. He discovers that the manager he has hired is not diligently and honestly looking after his affairs. Consequently, he tells him that he cannot be his manager any longer and he wants him to give an account of his management work. The manager panics because he's about to lose his job and he doesn't know what he's going to do. He decides that perhaps if he eliminates much of the debt that other people owe his boss, that after he is dismissed, maybe they will give him a job out of gratitude for saving them so much. The rich man learns of what his dishonest manager has done and then commends him for acting shrewdly and creating the potential of making friends with the other business people. It is the making of friends for yourselves that Jesus raises up as the thing of great value here. However, the actions of the steward also made friends for the master. The village or the community where the rich man lived and did business, they all would have been celebrating the master's generosity in forgiving a major portion of the debts that were owed to him. They would not have seen it as the steward's actions, but the master's actions through the steward. They would have thought that the steward was acting on the instructions of the master in the reduction of the debt. Now, the master could have had the steward's actions undone because he didn't have the authority to do that, and he could have had the steward thrown in jail for his dishonesty. But if the master did that, it would have affected his relationship with others. Those that were surprised and overjoyed and likely shared their good news with others, instead of seeing the master as a kind and generous person who had their best interest in mind, would have seen him as a harsh and cold person looking out only for his own interests if he undid everything that the steward had done. The steward's actions actually upped their opinion of the master more than it did of the steward. They would have seen the steward as only doing his job according to the master's instructions. So the steward's dishonesty would have resulted in a positive change in the people's attitude toward and willingness to connect with the master. Then Jesus said to them, and this is from the First Nations version, "Do you see what this means? The children of darkness are sometimes wiser in the ways of this world than the children of light are in the ways of the spirit world above. So then use the possessions of this world to help others in need, who will become your friends. Then, when these possessions run out, these new friends of you and God will always welcome you into their homes." When these possessions run out, the possessions of this world, the social structures of this world will fade and do fade. History has revealed that. They do not sustain us. But what does sustain us as we journey through life is our relationships with one another, not our independence, which is only possible and sustained by the possessions of this world that we accumulate. In the parable, it was the forgiveness of debt and the wise compassion of the master that was going to nurture and sustain the relationships, not the holding tight to resources and possessions. Jesus emptied all that he had to turn us into friends. Jesus poured everything out on us in his life, in his death, and in his resurrection. Jesus' love for us transformed the world. When we make friends, something mysterious and often as unclear as a muddy window happens. Jesus tells us where two or three are gathered that he is also present. When we reach out and make friends, the Holy Spirit is present and touches us and touches our new friend. We might miss it, but it's still a reality. We know only in part. We see as if through a muddy window, but that does not change the reality that God is present with us in our relationships of forgiving and caring and loving one another. There is nothing in all of creation that could be more valuable than the presence of God in our lives. Do we know that? Jesus is telling us it does not matter how we get there. Just take a step toward the mystery and the reality of the presence of God alive in our loving and caring for one another, and we will get glimpses of the glory and the reality of God, even if it only seems like a ray of light coming through a muddy window, because one day the mud will be cleared off and we will fully know the glory that can touch us even now. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, as we gather this day to celebrate our relationship with you, to celebrate your incredible love for us. May your Holy Spirit touch us and fill us with the joy of knowing you. Come, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Joined with my life, I sing in vain tonight. So the words I say and the things I do make my life so sing, bring a smile to you. So let my life so true, if my life so sings.
Please stand together and turn to page 188. The words of the Nicene Creed, let us confess our faith as we say, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As we come before our Lord in prayer, I invite you to stand, sit, or kneel.
Morning, leaving my glasses behind, but I'm bothering my wife's. It's not often that we see eye to eye. Remember what your people bow before you and those who are absent through age, sickness, or any other cause. Care for the infants. Guide the young, support the aged, inspire the faint-hearted, and bring the wandering to your fold. Journey with the travelers, necessity, heal the sick, especially at this time. We pray for Fred Belsham, for Paul, Dawn, Kevin, and Fern, and anyone else that we pause for a bit to hold up before God. Strengthen all who are in tribulation, necessity, or distress. Remember for good those who love us, and those who hate us, and those who have asked us, unworthy as we are, to pray for them. Remember especially, Lord, those whom we have forgotten. For you are the helper of the helpless, the savior of the lost, the refuge of the wanderer, the healer of the sick. You know the need of all and have heard each prayer. Save us in your merciful loving kindness and eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray for the royal family. Almighty God, the fountain of all goodness, we remember our Queen of Canada. May she rest in peace and light perpetual shine upon her, and may she rise in the resurrection. Now, we pray, bless our sovereign King Charles III and all the royal family. endue them with your Holy Spirit, enrich them with your heavenly grace, prosper them with all happiness, and bring them to your everlasting kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Prayer of Thanksgiving. O Lord God, we thank you for all your blessings, for life and health, for laughter and fun, for all our powers of mind and body, for our homes, and the love of dear ones, for everything that is beautiful, good and true. But above all, we thank you for giving your Son to be our Savior and friend. May we always find our true happiness in pleasing you and helping others to know and love you, for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen.
Amen.
This morning we are going to have an opportunity for prayers for healing and anointing, as we have done in the past. I would invite anyone to come forward at this time, one at a time, or in pairs, who would like to have healing or anointing. Thank you.
we continue in prayer. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to this table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess
that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Please stand. My brothers and sisters, our Lord Jesus comes to us and offers us his peace. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
May we acknowledge God's peace with one another. As we prepare to come to our Lord's table and our offerings are received, let us join in singing together hymn number 374, Hallelujah, Sing to Jesus. gifts printed in your bulletin. Let us pray. God of power, the glory of your words fills us with wonder and awe. Accept our offering this day and help us live in peace and harmony with all your creation. For the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue with Eucharistic Prayer 2, found on page 196. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. He is your living Word, through whom you have created all things. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh of the Virgin Mary and shared our human nature. He lived and died as one of us to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to bring release to those who placed their hope in you. And so he won for you a holy people. He chose to bear our griefs and sorrows and to give up his life on the cross, that he might shatter the chains of evil and death and banish the darkness of sin and despair. By his resurrection, he brings us into the light of your presence. Now, with all creation, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Accept our praise. Through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on the night he was handed over to suffering and death, took bread and gave you thanks, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This is my blood, which is shed for you. When you do this, you do it in memory. Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we offer you this bread and this cup, giving thanks that you have made us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon the offering of your Holy Church, gathering into one all who share in these sacred mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory. Through your servant, Jesus Christ. All glory and honor are yours, Father and Son, with the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Church, now and forever.
Amen.
Bottom of page 211. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Number 1 on page 212. I am the bread of life, says the Lord. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never thirst.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are they who trust in him.
This is the table not of the righteous, but of the poor in spirit. It has been made ready for those who love Christ and those who want to love God in Christ alone. So come, you who have much faith and you who have little. You who come to this sacrament often and you who have not been for a long time or ever before. You who have tried to follow Jesus and all of us who have failed. Come not because it is I who invite you. It is Christ who invites you to meet him here.
Of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to see us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross.
Please join in the prayer after communion printed in your book. Let us pray. Ruler of the universe, all creation yearns for its fulfillment in your Son. May we who have shared in holy things grow into maturity in him. This we ask in the name of the same Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God,
whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine.
Glory to God from generation to generation, in the Church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever.
Amen.
The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forevermore.
Amen.
Yeah.
I was going to speak last week about ordering the calendars, but it was a jam-packed service last week, So this week, my book for signing up for calendars is out in my car, but the calendars for the Anglican Church for 2023 are now going to be ordered. So if you would like to get one, if you could let me know and sign up so that we can give you your calendar when it arrives. They're $6 each this year.
Thank you, Phil. Just one announcement. There's an error in the bulletin. Next Sunday is not Holy Communion. It is morning prayer. That time of service where we acknowledge anniversaries of marriage and birthdays. Any anniversaries that we haven't known about? Any birthdays? Oh, Fred. Father Fred.
We have a remnant of my birthday celebration with some friends, Pete and Richard, and my daughter from Barrie, Ontario, is visiting as well. So, anyway, we're here. We had a good celebration.
Okay, any others? We have one of our own. Well, not that Fred isn't one of our own, but this is a unique individual as far as I'm concerned. Garrett Bilks is having a birthday this week. And believe it or not, because I didn't until I looked about three times, he's turning 82. So, birthday boys, please stand. Lord, we ask that you always be the center of our lives and allow us to find peace and happiness in your presence. Help us to love one another as you love us. Lord, we are thankful today for the opportunity to share with our friends a special day in their lives. We would ask that you watch over them, allow them health of body, mind, and spirit, and that you continue to bless this community by their presence. Amen.
Amen.
You might have noticed the tables were set up differently when you came in. So in case you didn't know, it's Salad Sunday. You are all invited. There's a wide variety of salads. And you could, there's some spots to sit inside, or the weather is nice. If you can handle holding a plate and eating standing, you can go outside and enjoy the fresh air with one another. But please stay and enjoy some time together.
I did forget. What a wonderful presence this morning. And the old saying, Anglican saying is, if you feed them, they will come. It's true.
Please stand together and join in singing hymn number 430, Will You Come and Follow Me?
Thank you.
brothers and sisters in Christ, go forth in peace to love and serve our Lord.
Thanks be to God.